So thanks everyone for being here. Manuel Barron. I'm gonna talk about monitoring indoor air quality. I think it's the first time in my life I'm actually competing with Max of Hammer, who has the like farther away presentation from an Ignite presentation. So let me start by asking, why should we monitor indoor air pollution? Monitors are not cheap. The field logistics are complicated. You need not only monitors, but laptops, batteries, cables, software. If you're gonna cross international borders, you need really good luck with customs. Once you get there, you need to train personnel, put protocols in place, ensure that people comply, your field staff comply closely with these protocols. You need to visit households multiple times. So, because if you're gonna place a monitor, you need to go back and retrieve it, right? So why should we do it? Why should we bother if it's so complicated, so expensive? I mean, especially if you can sometimes in labs, you can compare the emissions from different types of technologies and just get an idea of what's going on with different technologies. I think the main reason is that measurements in the field diverge dramatically from measurements in labs, mainly due to behavioral reasons. And given that indoor air pollution is the third largest risk factor in the global burden of disease, we really need to make sure that we know if the policies we're putting in place are having any effect at all in reducing it. The main example I'm going to talk through today, I'm going to mention three technologies. Two of them are we applied already in El Salvador in a joint project with Maximo Toledo from IFPRI, where we ask, if there is a relevant relationship between kerosene use and indoor air quality. Keyword here is relevant, because although there's a mechanical relationship, once you turn off a kerosene lamp, emissions will go down. The emissions from biomass used for cooking are so large that they may dwarf any improvements arising from changes in kerosene use. So to answer this empirical question, we use the UC Berkeley particulate and temperature sensor to monitor fine particulate matter concentration in a sample of rural households in El Salvador during a grid expansion program. I don't know if you can see, we have the monitor over there. It looks like a smoke alarm. It is actually constructed inside a smoke alarm. It's a rigged smoke alarm. You can see right here the kerosene lamp. You can see the smoke, and then you can see Jesus Christ. If you if you smell the kerosene, you'll see other faces as well. No, it's pretty nasty. But more importantly, what this monitor gives us is this type of data. So we have fine particulate matter concentration at the 1 minute resolution. So minute by minute of the day, we know if there are spikes, if there are throughs, and we can analyze and cut this data in many different ways. I'm not gonna have time to show you. This is the first time actually in a presentation I skip through my results to get to important points. And I'm gonna get to the second technology, which is, Lucas talked about it in his presentation, the iButton temperature sensor, also known as the SAMs, stove usage monitors. But they are, I mean, we use them basically to measure temperature in kerosene lamps, and by taking the difference between lamp and room temperature, we can infer if the lamp was on or off. These are cheap devices, $20 to $30, depending on the specification. They are very sturdy, they are very durable, reliable, and I'm currently analyzing the data on this type of, on these devices. Finally, the third technology I want to present is work in progress. It's aimed at measuring exposure to fine particulate matter. If you think of, concentration is the amount of particulate matter in a room, and exposure in a nutshell is how much of this pollution goes into people's systems, how much we breathe in a day. In my paper with Maximo, we measured it just based on recall data, which is highly, highly imperfect. And in order to produce a better measure, I'm working with Nick Lam and AJ Pilaceretti from the Department of Public Health, based on previous work by Tracy Allen with funding from CEGA. Thank you, guys. On a receiver, on a device called the Time Activity Monitoring System. This is a device that can tell us if a person, objectively, if a person is present in a room or not at a 1 minute resolution. We love the 1 minute resolutions here. So it basically works like we have a receiver that we place either in a pollution source like a kerosene lamp or in just in a room or in the stove or close to the stove. And we place tags on, people wear tags. And the transmitter will tell us if the tags are in its vicinity, so we can infer if the person was in the room or not when the device was operating. Of course, there's potential issues with compliance, with the Hawthorne effects, and I'm happy to talk about them in the Q&A session. But I wanted to point another application of this device, maybe for the rebound effect, if we see that people are using their ACs more often, or if they are using heat lamps for longer, we can also know if they are in the room enjoying this nicer temperature, or if they're outside just wasting the cheaper energy. I think that's a cool application. This is a little far into the future because we are working now on the device itself. You can see it in the corner. I'm always happy to talk about it. But to finalize, I know this is a really fast talk. I wanted to show you how these three technologies can be combined to get better measures of exposure. First, this is indoor air pollution concentration in a kitchen. In the vertical axis, we have fine particulate matter concentration. In the horizontal axis, we have time of the day, or the 1 minute resolution. We could assign, if we think of a cook, of a person in the kitchen, we could assign the cook an exposure equal to the mean concentration in the room. Thank you. Let's say 0.098. But if we combine that with presence in the room, these green dots that look like lines because they are so finely measured, we could get a better estimate because this person, let's say, left the kitchen for a few minutes of high exposure, and we get a lower estimate, actually more accurate. And finally, we can combine that with these blue dots of stove usage, and we can kind of, at least indirectly, say, or I don't know if say, but we could see if the stove was being used at that point in time. If we put more stove usage, stove monitors, we could put more monitors and lamps, heat lamps or kerosene lamps, and see if these things, what is contributing to exposure. So these things can get very complicated, but we can always think about how to make the logistics flow more easily and more efficiently to answer very important questions for public health, I believe. So thank you for your attention.